No matter your budget for a new CPU, both Intel and AMD will have at least one option to offer, but making the actual choice is not always very simple. Right now, apparently Zen 4 processors, like Ryzen 7000, seem to be the overall better choices than the competition's alternatives, with better power consumption, slightly lower temperatures, and most importantly, a better price, except it's not like that. In reality, both current generation platforms from both Intel and AMD suffer from the same shortcomings. Power consumption over 100 watts, even on Ryzen 5 and Core i5, temperatures so high that even for both teams' 7 series models you need a solid cooler, very expensive motherboards, and last but not least, stability issues here and there. But as crappy as it may sound, it's somewhat normal. You see, these are the side effects of switching to new platforms. AMD introduced the AM5 socket and made the leap to DDR5 and PCI Express 5.0, and Intel is still offering support for both DDR5 and the older DDR4 standard. As always, when new hardware shows up, new problems emerge. But despite what I said before, it seems this time the issues are disappearing a bit faster than they used to. I still remember how long it took me to get my first Ryzen PC in working order. So today we meet the next wave of releases, namely the new 7000 CPUs, but this time without the X joining them. We've made an abrupt transition because this is actually the real coming of Zen 4. Enter Ryzen 5 7600, Ryzen 7 7700 and Ryzen 9 7900. And make no mistake, each of the new CPUs comes with a stock cooler in the box. I'm sure you have lots of questions about them, so stay with me in this video as I'll try to answer them all. The easiest way to understand the differences between the new processors and their X-tail models is to compare them. And we see pretty quickly that the differences are not that big. The Ryzen 7900 comes with a boost frequency of 5.3 GHz, a difference of only 300 MHz compared to the 5.6 peak that the 7900X achieves. The base frequency is significantly lower, but in use it makes no difference, and the cache memory is exactly the same. A massive change is seen in the TDP, which has dropped from 170 watts to just 65 for the non-X variant. This is the same for all other non-X models. The TDP is fixed at 65 watts. In the case of the Ryzen 7700, we see a difference of only 100 MHz compared to the 7700X with the same cache memory, but 40 watts less power consumption. And the last one is the Ryzen 7600, which goes up to 5.1 GHz compared to 5.3 on the 7600X, but with a lower power consumption. 65 watts versus 105. With this massive drop in TDP, things have changed on the cooling side as well. If AMD recommends we use a 240 mm AIO system for Ryzen 7700X, with the new models they also offer stock cooling in the package. Ryzen 7900 and 7700 come with Wraith Prism, RGB included. And even though we're talking about the same power consumption, the Ryzen 7600 comes with the Wraith Stealth cooling. Now, lower consumption doesn't necessarily fix everything. Temperatures will still be an issue to some extent, so the cooling solution included in the package is more of a placeholder that needs to be replaced sooner or later. But it's there. This is somehow mocking the competition as well. For those who didn't know, Intel has already released its 13th generation non-K CPUs. The dudes just didn't announce it to anyone, they didn't even do a minimal showcase event, we just found them in the shops. No cooler, significantly lower specs, high power consumption, the whole deal. Now, with the new AMD processors, it looks like the Ryzen 7000 family is almost complete. At the moment, we're missing the very affordable Ryzen 3 models, but sooner or later, we will have them too. And speaking of price, the news is good. The Ryzen 7600 non-X has a starting price of about $230. That means affordable CPUs that offer good performance are back in the game. The Ryzen 7700 will be somewhere around $330, while the Ryzen 7900 has an MSRP of $430. To better understand what I'm saying here, the 7600X is $300, the 7700X is $400, and the 7900X hovers around $550. With the new CPUs, we have better prices, lower power consumption, and automatically more manageable temperatures compared to the X-Tail models. Pirate movies have taught us that the X marks the spot. In the case of AMD processors, the X marks the higher frequencies, so the new models are not as fast as their bigger brothers. So my next task was to determine the performance difference, and to do the job I used the same hardware setup as I did when reviewing the first Zen 4 chips. An MSI X670E motherboard, 32GB of DDR5 memory, an RX 6950 XT graphic card, and a Samsung NVMe SSD. A direct comparison between the AMD Ryzen 7900X and the X-less version reveals a rather small difference. The faster variant has a percentage advantage, which leads me to believe that the extra frequency played an important role. Duh! The same goes for the other two models, 7700 and 7600, but they are almost as powerful as the X models. This is where I think it's important to remind you of the prices, because they will change the way we look at these results. The Ryzen 7600 and Ryzen 7700 are $70 cheaper than their X counterparts, while the Ryzen 9 7900 will save you about $120 if you choose it over a 7900X. And if you're not interested in squeezing every megahertz out of the CPU, it seems to me that the prices of the new processors are more than fair. That's considering they also come with a cooling solution in the box and have a lower TDP. With that in mind, perhaps my biggest curiosity remains how the youngest for now, the Ryzen 5 7600, performs in gaming. The bigger brother didn't fare too well. Even though they are somewhat affordable, the motherboards and the DDR5 memory modules were not at all wallet-friendly, so few people got their hands on a 7600X. I set the resolution to Full HD to work the CPU as much as possible and hopped into some of the more popular games. I've only included the FPS averages here to make the comparison easy to understand. The Ryzen 7600 got 598 FPS in CSGO, an insignificant difference from the 7600X, which got 604. In fact, all the comparisons I've done had pretty much the same results. Some 5 FPS difference in Cyberpunk, some more in Fortnite, 19 FPS difference in Shadow of the Tomb Raider, and a surprise in Metro Exodus, where the vanilla 7600 beat the 7600X by quite a margin. I think the results are enlightening. The processors ran at stock settings, locked at 65 watts TDP. If we unlock this limit and let them run free, intuition and experience tell me that we are talking about the exact same chips. Moving on to the number 7, the 7700 and 7700X were also extremely close to each other. The biggest differences are seen in CSGO and Fortnite, but both games ran well over 200 FPS. Next in line, Ryzen 9 and the duel between the 7900 and 7900X ends in a draw. I noticed late in my test session that the results in Metro Exodus are a bit off, but I think it has to do with some game update or GPU driver. But again, we're talking about some approximate numbers. What I wanted to point out is that none of the 6 CPUs is much above the others in the comparison. At the moment, the 7700X scores best and has proven to be the most gaming CPU of these, but even here, the difference is quite small. We're left with one more thing to discuss, so we're now getting into the touchy area: power consumption and temperatures. The non-X CPUs have a huge advantage in this category because their TDP, as I said, is locked at 65 watts. But I want to make one thing clear right away, so there is no quibbling later. The TDP of a CPU is not an exact indicator of its consumption, so for AMD, the calculation sounds like this. The TDP is multiplied by 1.35 to get the real consumption. Easy math, 65 times 1.35 equals 87.75 watts. In practice, the three processors fell squarely within this limit, with the only one that pulled slightly over being the Ryzen 9 7900 with its 12 cores and 24 threads. And it's also on this one that I measured the temperatures. Being the most powerful and the thirstiest of all three, I mounted the Wraith Spire Prism cooler on it and ran some tests. In benchmarks, I saw a maximum temperature of about 80 degrees Celsius, while in games I reached 83. Keep in mind though that this is possible with the included cooling, and processors like Intel Core i7 13700K or Ryzen 7700X require water cooling with a minimum 240mm radiator or a tower like Noctua NH-D15. I cooled this one with the AMD's default windmill. What more could I ask for? And with even more potential hidden behind the power limiter, I think the new Ryzens are the real deal. And it feels like 2017 again when I was introduced to the first Ryzen processors. I'm looking at something new that started out in pretty rough shape, but has evolved nicely into its best version. And this time, it only took about 4 months after the Ryzen 7000X processors came out for the series to evolve and refine. And the timing couldn't be better. We're finally seeing a price drop for AM5 socket motherboards. In addition, more and more models are appearing, and with the B650 chipset and the possible A chipset on its way, prices will only go down. DDR5 memory has also seen some significant price drops, and somewhere towards the end of this year, prices for new DDR5 modules will reach the level of DDR4. And since cooling is in the package, you save some more dollars from the total cost of the system, and suddenly the Ryzen 7000 non-X series sounds damn good. And now, you tell me, how do you find the new batch of AMD 7000 series CPUs? Sounds like a good investment or not? You would expect that with a lower price and lower power consumption, the performance difference would be significantly higher, but it isn't. And most users probably won't even feel the gaps, or at least won't feel them very much. And with that, I can honestly say it's been a pleasure to test them and a joy to bring some good news to a market where prices have given us enough headaches in recent years. They're not cheap indeed, but the price-quality ratio has finally reached a much desired balance. I rest my case and hope you liked this video. Why not toss a subscribe to this channel and stay tuned for more? Thank you.